First Winter by Yasmin Joseph. Scene 1. A sunny day in St. Andrews, Jamaica. Hyacinth is in the kitchen preparing fish. She works diligently, scraping away at the scales and then slicing them into very precise, fair portions.
I've been told I have healing hands. Sometimes Mommy will come home and before she speaks, I can just see it. Sketch into her brow. Worry and noise. And the pressure of having to carry those things on a head held high with a neck that's tired. We don't really discuss it. She just sits down, usually here.
Hyacinth points to a chair, washes her hands.
And I place my hands over her head like this.
Hyacinth takes the stance of a sorcerer.
And wait. And I can't quite describe what I'm waiting for. There's nothing to signify when the pain ends or lessens or when the healing begins. There's no bell, no whistle. It's just a feeling. When her shoulders slacken and she loses her collar, the corners of her mouth turn into a smile and she walks away lighter. Like she has clouds in her shoes.
Bridgetown, Barbados. Esther is peeking through the shutters. Her sister Ingrid is in a world of her own, easing into a book.
The doctor just came.
Esther, mind your business.
Okay, I'm minding my business, but the doctor just came.
That doesn't sound like minding your business to me.
Miss Thina is out there crying and hollering.
Sounds about right.
Every time she gets closer to the ground, she does it like this.
Demonstrates an elaborate and elegant form.
So the doctor can get a better look at her dress.
Well, she's not a married woman. Can't knock her for trying.
I don't like it.
It's not your business to be liked.
All this crying and hollering when she never so much as brought the man a mango to lift his sugars. After all he did for her.
Come away from the window.
Ingrid, nobody tied Jeff and he's snapping after the doctor's foot.
Come away from the window now.
Esther comes and sits beside her sister, reluctantly.
You think that's fair?
Ingrid doesn't answer, sinks further into her book.
Poor man, deserved better than that.
It's not fair, it's life.
Well, it hurts my heart.
Never mind, your heart will repair.
Never. So where will he go?
Ingrid running out of patience now.
What do you mean, where will he go?
Where will they take him?
Probably to the hospital.
And then?
To the mortuary.
And then?
To the grave.
And then?
Ingrid puts down her book. She spots something in her little sister that needs healing. She takes her time.
And then there is a journey he has to go on his own.
To where?
Esther, stop acting like you don't have a Bible.
So, that's just it?
He lived a long life.
No one should have to die alone. It was not enough to leave a bowl of soup on the veranda. Holler out his name when you pass. No one held his hand.
Esther, sometimes that's just how it be. It's not everyone you have around all those years that'll be there on the final day. People drift.
You remember when Daddy sent me to check on Uncle Edwin in St. Peter? And you know how he traps you for the company?
Uncle Edwin knows how to feel.
3 times I said, no, Uncle Edwin. Thank you, Uncle Edwin, but I'm full. No more, please, Uncle Edwin, because I will pop. And he just kept going with prayer and stories, asking me about school, then broth, then 3 different kinds of cake. I just fell asleep. But when the dark came, it wasn't like when me and you are together. I've never felt a longer journey home. Everything just sounded different. Even the places I knew, the rustling in the bushes, holding my hand in front of my eyes and watching it vanish into the black. I had to cut through the air until I could see you, tiny like an ant, but your feet tapping, vexed because I was late. I could hear how mad you were in your voice, how scared. What time do you call this? But still, I'd never been more happy to see your shape just floating there in the distance, something to move towards.
She goes back to the shutters, peering out.
I imagine that's what it feels like to go. That fear that you can't even explain when you're standing in the same world, but it all looks strange. And no one was with him.
If he's been a good man, he'll have nothing to worry about.
She touches Esther in some way.
Maybe someone will be waiting for him on the other side. Esther comes away.
Carmelita, Belize. Patsy is in a careers meeting at school. She's been talking for quite some time, her quick, sharp mind darting here and there. We meet Mr. Simmons, struggling to keep up.
Getting lost in stories and fantasy is the work of luxuriating white women. That's why my grandmother says, I can't be a librarian. She says it's idle.
Interesting. Have you?
In our house, the work we do requires us to open our eyes and see, be of use, look around and find what has to be done.
She looks around. She's uninspired.
What does that even mean?
Have you thought about?
Sometimes, I want to take my brain out of my head and give it to the highest bidder in the village. I want to wrap it up well. It's very valuable, you know, and get it as far away from this house as possible.
And why is that, Patsy? Why would you like to take your brain out of your head and sell it?
Because it's become my prison, and the money might help.
I think you're being very hard on yourself.
I think I'm being honest.
Mr. Simmons gives Patsy a look, a reminder that he's the adult in the conversation and she's starting to be precocious.
Patsy, how about we refocus this conversation? The purpose of this meeting is to determine which career path you think you might be most suited to. So far, you've told me about everything you can't and won't do. So what about the things that interest you?
Silence. Patsy thinks. She's at a loss and is quickly losing interest in this conversation, perhaps finding things to fidget with on his desk.
Come on, I can't be that hard. The world is your oyster, as they say. You're a very intelligent young woman, yet you've got a little way to go. But your grades this term have been quite strong.
Quite strong? Quite strong? When she's working three jobs for me to be here. Mr. Simmons, have you met my grandmother?
He has, and he's also felt the prickly heat of her grandmother's disappointment before. Momentarily, the memory flashes before his eyes. The feeling is familiar.
Let me share something with you, Patsy.
Patsy obliges. Nothing else is happening.
My father was a strong man, strong in more ways than one. I can show you bricks he laid with his bare hands that withstood every hurricane. When I was a child, I thought he was a giant. In many sense, he was. He used to make boats, and I watched him and my brother working out in the yard, big pieces of timber tossed over their shoulders like rods. And the second, I'd join in, you could see my eye about to jump from my head, my knees threatening to snap like a twig you could find out on the playground. They never understood me, but I came to understand that my power was quieter. And that was okay.
Patsy really takes this in.
If we are not careful, we can spend our whole lives chasing other people's dreams.
Hyacinth's fish is now seasoned and ready to be cooked. She moves on to peeling and chopping some green banana.
And when I see Mommy get up and walk away, her shoulders a little more solid than when she walked through the door. Enough energy now to pick up the boys and play, maybe dance, I feel relieved. Because see Mommy, she holds a lot. There's not a problem you can rest by her feet that she don't pick up and squeeze to fix in her heart. But when I came home clutching my belly, I had a forever gift from a love that wouldn't last, worried about shame. She just shuffled, looking at me knowing, rubbed two fingers on her temple, stared into the yard and said, you know, I did you fish 3 nights ago, parrot fish, the bluest blue you ever seen. I raised him like my own. Junior will have a brother and he will study your book. People will have to mind their business.
Hyacinth remembers her mother's sacrifice. She puts more of herself into preparing this meal.
So when she comes home and I see that heaviness above her brow, I just place my hands over her head. We don't speak because we don't need to. The look in her eyes is always enough. Just warm and ready to sink in and rest. It says, good girl, kind, beautiful girl. And my chest feels warm in the silence because I know her mouth can't make those shapes. That's enough, and has always been enough.
She goes back into her work, looking at the fish before cooking it.
How this could feed 5,000 and in before the belly stretches to full, huh?
She calls off stage.
Junior, Marcus, if I have to call you again,
she busies herself until there's nothing left to do, just her and her thoughts. And in that moment, we see her hands looking for a purpose. She wrings them. Draped around her shoulders is a weight that she's never sought to question or understand, maybe until this day.
Sometimes when I think about Mommy and how she say I have the power to heal.
She looks at her hands, inspects them.
I wonder if my power might weep. I wonder why I can only use it in this four walls.
Well, I don't think I can be a mother. I don't like babies.
That isn't what I had in mind when I said career.
And I don't have the patience for marriage.
Good to know your limits.
I can't be a seamstress. I don't have a steady hand.
I think there's more to the craft than that.
Not interested in teaching, because why spend all that time focused on ideas that aren't mine?
So that's it now. You're going to go and save the world, all because of old Mr. Lewis?
That's right.
And how do you plan on doing that?
Esther takes a moment to think it through.
Well, firstly, I'm going to get rich.
Ooh. Well, don't forget your sister.
Very rich. And then I'm going to buy a huge house.
Mm-hmm. Bigger than this.
This can fit into my house 3 times.
Ingrid is excited now and buying into the dream.
Yeah. And me and Mommy can come and stay?
Yes, if you do the cleaning. But I'll have the biggest room.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
And Daddy, he can take care of the garden, speak to all the flowers like you know he likes to do.
And you won't be lonely in that big old house when we are not around.
No, because I'll use it to take care of anyone who gets sick on my street.
Ingrid, laughing teasingly, but also proud. It's good to dream.
Yes.
She's forgotten what it feels like. She kisses Esther on the head.
Esther, you're not easy.
Well, there was this one thing.
Mr. Simmons is on his last legs now and desperate to escape for lunch, for anything.
What is it, Patsy, for the love of God?
I had a fever last summer.
Mr. Simmons wonders, where on earth is this leading?
Grandma touched my head, boiled me some bush tea, said it would pass. But it didn't. I couldn't speak for that day and the next. She got scared and sent for the doctor. And I just remember how quickly he moved, like a magician, pulling out all these tricks out of his pocket. He took my mind off my body feeling so heavy. And the strange cold thermometer sitting under my tongue, watching it fill with color so high that it was about to explode. He taught me how it worked.
She thinks for a while.
I can move that fast.
Mr. Simmons smiles. Hyacinth takes out 4 plates, begins to serve the food.
So, it cooked for too long. Must have let my mind run away. Junior, Marcus!
The 3 worlds bleeding into one now.
Dinner!
No one would die alone.
Evening, Mommy. Your dinner's on the side.
Nursing?
Nothing special, Mommy, just the same.
And in my big house, everyone would be happy.
Nursing is going to smell funny.
And feel loved.
Nothing, Mommy. Just things on my mind.
Journey. Scene 2. A few years have passed. Hyacinth, Esther, and Patsy in their separate worlds, gradually lit one by one. Patsy, alone in her room, holds the envelope up to the light, sniffs it.
Smell foreign.
Weighs it as if her hand were scale.
Seems too light for good news, but a bit too heavy for bad news.
She anxiously ponders her next move. Esther and Ingrid stand around the unopened envelope like it could detonate at any second. After some time.
You want me to open it?
Yep.
Okay.
Ingrid cautiously approaches. She picks it up.
Put it down.
Esther.
I'm not ready yet.
We can't just leave it here all week.
I know.
Hyacinth's letter is already open and she's reading it. From the horror on her face, you can't tell what's going on.
10 handwritten letters.
I know.
10 handwritten letters for each application window in my finest pen.
I know, baby.
If it's not no response, then it's not this time.
But it could be good. Things are really opening up. You read what they said in the papers. It's not begging to go to the people's country, you know. They need us there. That place needs fixing.
Oh, my. Oh. I never thought they would. They said lots of girls would apply. I never.
The news begins to sink beneath her skin. She lets out a squeal and jumps up and down. Then she places a hand over her mouth in disbelief, studies the letter again.
Okay, open it.
Finally.
And if it's good news, nod your head.
Okay.
If it's bad, leave.
And go away when this is my house.
I don't know. Just make sure it's far away.
Ingrid opens and begins to read, inspecting every word twice over. Esther waits on the edge of her seat. Patsy is standing triumphantly, trying to control the fact that she is ready to burst at the seams.
Oh, Patsy Young, it is our pleasure to inform you that you have been accepted onto the NHS Nurses Training Program at Bedford Midland Hospital. Well, I'm pleased to see the English people have good sense. I would pick me.
Hyacinth, with worry now. Overwhelmed.
But Mommy, and the boy, Marcus. I can't leave Marcus.
Hyacinth searches for answers. Ingrid with the letter, her expression calm and unclear.
You look like something's wrong. Ingrid?
You did it.
A question in her voice.
You really did it.
Esther waits. She's not quite sure what for.
Well, we have a nurse in the house. We better tidy up nice. They all want to horse for the news.
Esther looks at her big sister to see if it's okay to be happy. Something inside her heart deflates. Scene 3. Hyacinth is packing a suitcase. She does so thoughtfully, really considering each item before folding it neatly.
When Mommy came home that night, I did feel frightened to speak to her, like I broke something in the house. One of her good china plates for birthdays or when the parson comes around. And I shuffled this way and the next. You thirsty, Mommy? You want a drink? Something stronger? Until finally she looked me in my eye with that face that knows everything and said, Hyacinth, spit it out. I said I thought it might be good to have some change. Change is good for people, makes them grow. I wanted to be an example for the boys, for Marcus. She's been so good to both of us, but it was time to stand on my own 2 feet as a woman, a mother. I needed to do something he could be proud of, spread my wings, and maybe let him spread his. I said, no matter what, my family would always come first. I would always help. Do what I can. In fact, Marcus and Junior, I could send for them if they could stop fighting long enough about who is uncle and who is brother. Maybe they too could chase a dream. She laughed, but it wasn't a deep laugh like always, from her belly. How much? I slipped the paper across the table. She just nodded, rubbed her palms. I'll take up some more hours. I watched her do the math quickly behind her eyes, knowing that wouldn't be enough. Your father put something away. The boys didn't say much at first. I noticed Junior trying to pop in shirt a little more than normal, 2 hair on his chin now, trying to stand firm. Said he heard the girls were prettier in England, pretty which part? The girls don't even want him in Jamaica. And Marcus? Marcus just looked at me. I could tell he wanted to bury his head in the hem of my dress, like when he was small. Feeling Junior's eyes on his back, he said, I'm coming with you for protection. My boy, my big, strong boy. And Mommy, she just put on her record and smiled. Yes, me data gonna worrying. And she held onto her glass like it was keeping her steady.
Patsy is standing as her torso is measured for a coat.
England is just like Belize. Very clean and welcoming. Maybe a little milder. So you can afford to take a few inches off that waist. I won't need a big coat. Can't be looking like a parachute, you know. I want it to be quite fitting so that you get the shape of my uniform. Mr. Simmons said that's where all our exam papers are sent to be marked. So as you can see, our countries have a close connection. They'll be expecting me.
Esther is in the doctor's office for her medical. She's receiving an injection in her arm.
Ouch. Ouch, you're hurting me.
If you just hold still, please. Nearly there. All done. See, that wasn't so bad, was it?
Doctor releases Esther's arm and she snatches it back, a reminder of who it belongs to. Doctor isn't quite rough, but he isn't gentle. There's a coldness with how he handles Esther. He opens her mouth to look inside, flashes a torch in there.
So just the last few routine checks before final approval to travel. Any medications?
No.
Long-term conditions?
No.
He closes her mouth.
Is it possible that you might be pregnant?
I beg your pardon.
My cousin Errol's already there. He wrote and told me, come in the winter. By summer, you'll be thawed out.
Doctor is checking Esther's blood pressure.
I find some of these questions very strange.
Protocol, Miss Williams.
And this is how to do things over there? Rushing in and out like a factory?
I'm sure efficiency will be important, Miss Williams.
Poking and prodding and inspecting us? I'm sure care will be important too, Doctor. Treating people with dignity.
We just want to ensure that we are sending them our very best.
Ah, yes. Never good for an island to slack on the quality of its exports.
Doctor smiles something thin. Esther straightens her back. He inspects her notes. Patsy has arrived at Mr. Simmons' office, uninvited.
Did you know about this?
I did.
Well, it must have been in the fine print.
It isn't a secret.
It's like inviting a guest and keeping them on the porch.
That's an interesting analogy.
Or telling them to come inside, but sitting them on the hardest chair so that they stay alert and ready to leave.
Lovely to see you haven't lost your gift of poetry.
I just find it rude, uninviting.
Well, the Brits pride themselves in their charm and good manners. To hear this, I'm sure they'll be quite surprised.
Mr. Simmons has a knowing look, seeing through the proud young woman firing questions to the scared little girl whose tears he used to wipe.
Patsy, it's customary for placement to request a return ticket pending on passing on your 12 weeks training, which I'm sure will be no issue for you. This shouldn't take away what you're going over there to achieve. It will still be an invaluable time to hone your skills for however long you're granted. A great and life-changing opportunity. The question is, what is it about returning home that's making you so uneasy?
Patsy fidgets and distracts herself. Hyacinth's packing is nearly complete.
Aunt Carol said this dress can be for church and special occasions.
She inspects it, finding joy in the details.
She used her finest cloth, said I must take it to England, make people come back here and find her for business.
She folds it and puts it away.
Mommy already wrapped me 2 yam, said the English like to eat like bird. And true, I am slender, the wind might sweep me away. It's like I fold and I fold and tuck, and there's still always something else that needs squeezing in.
She picks up a small wooden box. She holds it in her hand as if it's feather light, as if it might float away.
For my trinkets, my secrets, the few that I have, and trinkets.
She puts it back down.
So untidy for something so small, just mess and memories. The necklace Marcus made at school, for me, string and 2 shells. Letters, mommy's hairpin, my father's ring.
She holds the ring in her hand, looking around, waiting for a divine sign as to whether she's doing the right thing. Nothing comes. She contemplates the box. Something about putting it in the case makes her departure final.
I must remember my Bible.
She busies herself. Esther and Ingrid are in the kitchen, tidying up after a long evening of hosting guests. Ingrid is washing as Esther dries.
You see how Miss Henderson nearly falls down when she congratulates me? She smiled like this. Oh, what wonderful news. We're waiting on Griselda's acceptance letter. We're sure it will arrive shortly. The Minister of Health said things are quite backed up.
Esther's lips demonstrate that she's unconvinced.
And Daddy laughed so much tonight, I thought he might wake up the street. He said I must write him every week, tell him everything, from my dinners to how I'm sleeping. Mummy said the hospital will be busy when things start to get cold.
All the talk you're talking will be here all night. This house has been like a parade, and you are not in England yet. You don't have servants, so help if you are helping.
They continue to work in silence for some time. Esther holds onto her arm, still sore from her vaccination.
It's feeling heavy.
How long did the doctor say it would be?
A few days.
Work would help it wear off.
Ingrid indicates towards the dishes.
Ingrid, I'm sorry.
Ingrid momentarily stops her work, swallows the lump in her throat, continues.
Sorry, what you got to be sorry about? Let's just finish the job and done it late.
I'm sorry that I'm leaving you.
You don't have to sorry about leaving me. I am a big woman and I'll be okay.
Well, I'm sorry about all the fuss and people coming around and noise. I didn't want it.
That is not the problem.
Then what is? Because every time I catch your eye, you look away. And I don't want to feel lonely already, not before I even leave.
It's bigger than you. It's bigger than you, baby. Some of us were just born to fly, that's all. Don't let nobody slow you down, even me.
They continue to wash and dry, Esther longing to bury her head in her sister's arms, but settling for the closeness of their work. Scene 4. The sounds of busyness, destination call-outs, chatter. Patsy is ready to depart. She's dressed regally, but there's something childlike about the finishings, like a baby at christening, swallowed in frills to demonstrate the dressmaker's love.
Mr. Simmons brought along what felt like the entire school. All of them. They stood around me with signs and asked questions. Where will you sleep? Are you scared? Will you change your accent?
Patsy finds this funny.
Everybody talking to me as if I'm not the same girl they passed in the bakery just yesterday. Like I'm some strange bird. They inspected my coat, of course, freshly tailored and ready to meet the queen. And Mr. Simmons made a speech, the whole time his eyes looking wet and dabbing his brow under the hot sun whilst fidgeting with his blazer. My star pupil, off to make the country proud.
The enormity of his pride lands in her chest. It's a beauty and a burden.
Don't forget about us. Make sure you come back. And Grandma sat on a little stool, happily clapping her hands, finally able to rest her feet. Now I'm gone. The girls began to sing a hymn. The joy of discovery and new beginnings. A blessed farewell, Mr. Simmons said. All things bright and beautiful.
All creatures great and small.
All things wise and wonderful.
The Lord God made them all.
Each legal flood that opens,
each little bird that sings,
he made the glowing colors,
he made the tiny wings.
And for a second, the palm tree started waving, their droopy sway whispering in the wind. And I wondered if they were crying too. If they knew the truth, that I can't come back here empty-handed, not after everything Grandma sacrificed, not without a story to tell, without something to show. I wondered if they knew how much I wanted to curl up under their shade and say, tomorrow. Tomorrow, I'll be ready, just not today.
Hyacinth seated with her case looking out.
Mommy told Marcus to stop crying. Your mother not dead? So when he didn't know what to do with the sadness, Marcus shoved Junior in his chest and Mommy had to separate them. I grabbed Marcus, put both my hands on his face, trying to make his eyes meet mine. It's fight when you just want to fight when I'm gone. Son, he looked at the ground. And you, it's up to you to lead. Junior took my bag and hold it onto his back. His feet kicking up little dust clouds as he walked. And now when I close my eyes, all I can see is their two faces pressed against the railings, puffy red eyes. Tears falling off the cliffs of their cheeks like Don's River. Marcus wailing like he used to when I would leave him for school. And that same feeling like a magnet drawing me back to him. Wanting to scoop him and put his head on my chest, cover him with kisses, even though everybody tell me he's spoiled. I put my back down, turned back. One last, Mommy shook her head, no. Mommy stood firm, taller than I've seen her in weeks. She stepped away, came over and squeezed me tight, just like this.
She demonstrates the embrace. It isn't a hug, it's something deeper.
Like she was passing strength. Don't look back.
You have everything you need?
Esther nods, blinking back tears.
Check again.
Esther checks.
Passport, everything?
Esther nods.
Fix your collar. Let them know you come from somewhere.
Ingrid fixes Esther's collar.
And when you're speaking, make sure you always look people in their eye.
Both of them awkwardly wonder what to do next. Ingrid can't find any other detail to fuss over. She pulls Esther into her arms. They stay there for as long as time will allow, until finally, Ingrid holds her at arm's length for one last inspection.
I don't know who Daddy thinks he's fooling behind them shades.
I'll take care of them.
And what about you?
Ingrid doesn't know. She sets Esther on her way. Once she's far away enough, she leaves. Their worlds all dissolve into one. For a while, nothing but them and the islands they're leaving behind, shrinking smaller and smaller into the distance. The sounds of oceans, of hope, unfamiliarity, of a world opening, and these three excited and terrified young women cautiously stepping through its gates into the unknown. Scene 5. Hyacinth waiting on the roadside with her suitcase, taking in every detail of her surroundings.
I've never seen so many people at once. All looking like them had somewhere to be and running a day late. Buildings, tall, like they're piled on top of one another, racing to the sky. Judy and Marcus would know where to look. And Mommy would just say, this call is something wicked.
A reminder, she wraps herself up tight as instructed.
Cousin Errol came to collect me.
She looks on impressed.
Stepping out of a shiny car like royalty. Boy, back home they would laugh if they could see us right now.
She smiles to herself, feeling the distance.
I had to search for the space between this hat and scarf.
She finds it, inspects it.
Leaner, sharper, tied around the eyes, but still that same troublesome smile from when we were small. That you just ran from a beauty, and I wonder if you're still running here. And who are you running from? How you look so sad when you just touched down in the land of dreams?
Hyacinth shrugs.
He said it wouldn't last long, the longing. Pretty soon, the memories would start to drain off color. At first, he said he would walk his entire parish in his head every night before sleep, remembering every tree and stone, playing his daughter's laugh in his brain like a record on every beat. And then he filled his heart with music, with laughter, with love and memory, until he can hold her again. I wondered if it was different for me. I thought you might be hungry.
She rubs her belly, not sure it's ready for food after the journey. Besides, it's worth a try.
He hands me a hot piece of newspaper and, hell, it's England. Make you lose your manners, sir. Some newspaper you want your cousin to eat from when it's 3 years since we last met. Try it, cuz it's good. You're British now. And I unwrap and look inside, wondering if it was another one of his treats.
Patsy is on a train. She's diligently studying a book from page to page.
Mr. Simmons suggested a book to ensure I was fully prepared and informed ahead of starting, and I agreed. It is important to remain top of the class. I am representing my country after all.
Patsy straightens her back and adjusts her coat. But through the poise, we see she's afraid. She focuses again on the book.
In Place of Fear, by Aneurin Bevan, the founder of the National Health Service. He speaks so grandly about the duty of care society has to its people, about poverty as it were a moral thing, nothing to do with money. As if it were the absence of order and compassion civilization, like our work is never done, and our work is our wealth. Sounds like something Grandma would say. And I begin to wonder where I'm heading, if the gates of Bedford Midland Hospital will be golden and the sheets satin soft for everyone, from workers to politicians, to rest like they're somebody. I have a very important job to do. In the front cover, Mr. Simmons left a note. A place to bury your head. Food for your ever-thinking mind on the days when things get rough.
Patsy smiles, the title assuming a new and comforting meaning.
In place of fear.
Bedford Hospital, the nurse's living quarters. For the first time, Patsy, Hyacinth, and Esther become aware of each other's presence. Esther is noticeably inhibited. Throughout the scene, Matron sits between the worlds of all three characters.
Matron is a sturdy woman. No nonsense. She ushers us in single file.
Quickly, quickly, ladies. We don't have all day.
They enter together.
Voice is low and solid. Makes you stand up straight.
I'd hate to hear her shout.
And she speaks like the words travel off the slope of her nose and creep around the room, inspecting and ensuring they're heard.
There are some white girls near the entrance who just stare and point. They must like my jacket. In which case they should say,
we have some new girls here from overseas. They'll be joining us to train over at the hospital. So I expect you all to be welcoming and on your best behaviour. Would you like to share where you're all from?
Belize in Central America.
Jamaica.
Patsy and Hyacinth glances at Esther, who is in her own world, and indicate, your turn.
Barbados.
Speak up.
Barbados.
Excellent. So I'm sure that you'll all have lots in common.
They wonder if they do.
The rules here are simple. Work hard, rest when you can, tidy up after yourselves. Uniforms are to be left outside your doors in your laundry bag, collected on Wednesdays and returned on Fridays. Food is provided. The hospital is only a short walk away and you'll be shown once you're settled. There will be no unsupervised male guests under any circumstances, and curfew is at 10 p.m. sharp. Any questions? Good. Now follow me. I'll show you to your rooms.
The three women in their separate rooms.
Pink?
All this for me alone?
Wouldn't have been my first choice of colour.
Patsy takes out a cloth and begins dusting.
It's so quiet.
But I'm sure I can make some improvements here.
Patsy brings out some homely touches.
For now, I'll just try and fill it, make it mine.
Hyacinth does. She begins to unpack and move, filling every corner of her room, oddly enjoying having something to call her own, even if it does mean missing home. She places her trinket box on the table. She daren't open it. Esther steps inside, barely looks around. She silently approaches the window and takes a seat.
All set?
Esther nods, Matron observing how close she is to tears.
Be a tough girl now.
Esther looks out of her window, seeing not only the clouds and grey sky, but the ocean between her and her family. She breaks. Scene 6, Bedford Hospital. A hectic night shift, bells, the sound of doors opening and closing, coughing, crying, chatter. Patsy enters the stage hurriedly, uniform in pristine condition. She pushes the trolley. All of the women wear white belts and hats, which identify them as being in their first year of training.
I must say, for an institution so prestigious, I'm starting to see some cracks. Where I'm from, arriving early shows willing. It shows respect, preparedness, professionalism, and for that, you are rewarded. Tonight's reward? No instructions.
Hyacinth trying to placate a patient in the audience.
Madam, please, I can assure you I'm just as qualified. Madam, I do not appreciate being spoken to like that.
Esther holding a clean sheet.
So let me get this straight. If a child comes in and isn't contagious, then we don't change the sheets?
This is not how Esther would choose to do things.
And you're sure?
Patsy running the length of the stage, writing and delivering notes at regular intervals, enjoying the vigour of her tasks.
I can see why they needed us now. Good thing I'm fast. Good thing I learn quick. Heaven knows what might have happened.
Because, you see, I'm not very into cutting corners.
Sister!
And these instructions came directly from Sister? Well, if you're sure.
Madam, I cannot help you if you do not calm down. Sister, could you step in, please?
Esther being admonished for following the instructions she was given just moments before. She flinches under the scorch of invisible anger.
My apologies, Sister. I was told it was the right thing to do. Yes, I will use my common sense next time.
Patsy running another length of the stage, collecting all the notes she previously delivered. She's tired now, but tries not to show it.
Corridors long as the peninsula. Each ward a different village. Maya Beach, St. Bite, Placencia. 13 hours. Feet burning through the soles of my shoes.
The separate worlds dissolving now, becoming one. For a moment, a sleepy calm washes over the stage. Just as we're sinking into the quiet, an alarm rings, up again. But we wake in the future, weeks, maybe months later. Busy at work, we see change in the women.
Good morning, Matthew. And how is my favourite boy?
Sister, with respect, the English I'm speaking is proper.
It's good to see you back on your feet, sir.
Well, I can't stay with you the whole time, but
she leaves in whispers.
Maybe when I've finished upstairs, we could do some colouring in.
Bedpans again? And what will Kate be doing?
Not tonight. I have to study.
Do you have anyone to stay with you when you get home?
And what is sad face today? Tell Nurse William what's wrong.
I'm on it, sister. Consider it done.
Nothing we can't fix.
Yes, we do have electric where I'm from.
It's okay, sister. He meant no harm.
Toad in the hole. What I would give to get hold of two good plantains.
Do we wear grass skirts? Why, of course.
How's my special boy?
It's what they do. My little one was just the same.
Nurse William's favorite boy.
Mommy says I write more letters than he could read.
Now, what are you doing back here again? I thought we said no more visits this year.
My favorite smile.
You don't have to thank me like that, miss. It's my job I'm doing.
This has to be taken on time.
It's my pleasure to help you.
Move him closer to the window.
Very sunny. I miss it all the time.
Move him closer to the window so at night he gets the stars.
I'll rest when I'm done, and there's always something to do.
Soft as I can.
I'll hold your hand. I'll hold your hand, Nurse Williams' special boy.
Hyacinth and Patsy hold Esther's hands firmly, a touch that says, you did everything you could. Quiet for some time, an alarm again. Scene 7. Esther is alone in her room at the nurse's home.
Weeks turning into months of sitting by the window, waiting, looking out onto the green, just waiting to see Ingrid's shape appear through the fog. Her nightdress bunched in a knot near her knees, little feet tapping. What time do you call this? What time do you call this? And on those days, it feels like Barbados is reaching out to touch me. The salty sea breeze blowing all the way up to Until Road and finally to me in my bed. Until I have to stand up. I have to stand up and say, be brave. Wash your face and go. People need you.
Hyacinth is in a shebeen. She uses the last of the energy expended from a hard week's work to enjoy a slow and lulling dance alone.
Hope the English girls are starting to warm up. Sitting with me in the dining room, helping me here and there, telling me about their family, but mostly they ask about mine. They say things like, I could never leave my poppies, and I don't know how you do it. They continue their days as I carry their judgment that fills me like grief. But I've learned a new way about the English people. They're smiling and friendly stop at the door. See these people in the street on a Saturday afternoon and they will pass you like an exam. There's just a coldness. It sits between this person and the next. Sometimes it feels like we're only here to make everybody else warm. And giving kindness after kindness can get like taking the clothes off your own back.
Patsy using a public phone.
Grandma, I'm not complaining. Grades are on track. It's just hard, that's all. And when I get tired, it's hard too. Yes, I know what I came here to do. Still working towards my silver buckle. Yes, I'll send a picture for the mantle.
Patsy lowers the phone. Hyacinth, still dancing slowly.
It's been 3 months since Marcus last liked me. Mommy and Junior say it's just his age. Running around with friends feels like the most important thing. When I have enough to call, I'm starting to hear a little bass, scratch string voice. Yes, Mommy. No, Mommy. School is good, Mommy. And very little in between.
She smiles and sways her body through the hurt.
Until I came to England, I'd never had somebody turn down my ears. Never in my life. Or had people leave things on the surface, worried our fingers might brush. Back home, we're not scared to touch, to kiss and hug and laugh and slap on your friend knee when the jokes sweet you. Sarah was right. This is as close as it gets. A basement on Goswick Road. Getting to wear my good dress, Errol warning friends not to look on me for too long. I'm just laughing, dancing, stealing whatever time we have until home is our hand, whilst the colour slowly drains from our dreams.
The music builds in volume, builds into chants, sirens, shattered glass, hyacinth swings. Scene 8, an alarm. Our entry into the scene should feel like a jolt. The three women in their separate worlds trying to continue about their work. But beyond the hospital walls are the growing rumbles of dissent across the country, the sounds of riots and the ultimatums in the face of violent hate. At points, they may peer out of their respective windows as the trouble nears.
National identity.
I begged Errol to stop.
Britishness.
I begged Errol to just ignore them and walk on.
In all my books, in all of the papers, in every morsel I study and absorb, Britishness, national identity, and its shifting borders, changing with the revolving doors of politicians. As if it's this golden thing, this precious gem, placed just above our heads to where we can't reach.
In my family, we don't shout. Daddy always said, why abuse that voice the good Lord gave you? Choose your words and hold your power.
Well, Errol said, no. Why must they call us names and we walk on? Storm into our gatherings and we just pack up and go home. Turn the other cheek. People are tired and angry. And it's not just here in Bedford.
Power. I remember Daddy's words and every day I have to dig deeper to find them. Power.
I look at their speeches and policies like clumsily measured medicine poured into our mouths to keep us quiet.
People are in the streets, Hyacinth, from London to Nottingham and Leeds.
A Commonwealth Immigrants Act.
She pours a dose of medicine.
A Race Relation Act.
She pours a dose of medicine.
A Race Relation Act again, but revised.
She pours a dose of medicine.
Rivers of blood.
She pours another dose of medicine, heavily handed.
50 different prescriptions for the same sickness, whilst the patient is still writhing in pain.
And it's every island, he says. Grenadians, St. Lucians, Vincentians, Trinidadians, Guyanese, arm in arm, taking to the streets and protecting each other with spirit and song.
I walk through these doors and it's so noisy. Sometimes I wonder what shouting would even do. Who would even hear me if my voice would cause any ripples in the water?
The other night, there was another clash. Damage on both sides. They fought back. But one of Errol's friends got beat up real bad. And by the time I stepped in for my shift, two of them were sitting there, smiling as my stomach turned, waiting to be cleaned up, to patch up the remnants of their hateful work. And I looked at sister. My eye said, no. No, sister. Enough is enough. Someone else, please, anyone but me. And she looked at me firmly, turned on her heels, closing the door on my silence.
I have an important job to do.
Why abuse that voice the good Lord gave you?
We have an important job to do.
And some days when I look at my hands, tired and worn. I imagine them being charged by mommy's gratitude. I'll fill them with the life of my next dance, tracing the melodies with my fingertips.
The riots and descent continue. The day of the hospital winter ball. Esther, Hyacinth and Patsy are in the kitchen preparing food to be shared with the other members of staff.
And what time did you get in last night?
I don't want the other girls to hear. You know how they like to run behind matron.
What's it like?
You would know if you came.
Don't corrupt her.
Was it fun?
Fun? Girl, when I tell you, tunes drop like you wouldn't believe.
Hyacinth calls Esther in to dance and she giggles shyly.
All the new moves that find their way to Bedford from back home, like this.
Hyacinth demonstrates a move.
Serious?
Esther tries to copy it. She stops.
And was it safe?
Safe? Esther, put us anywhere in this country and the safest we'll feel is with our own people. Next time you have to come and see.
Esther gets excited.
We should be studying.
Hyacinth returns to her task, unconcerned about hiding her contempt for Patsy's constant focus on the rules. Esther slots back into her work also, conscious to stay on Patsy's good side.
Any spare time we have should be spent on our books. End of term exams are coming and nobody wants to be sending shame back home.
Daddy would be mad.
Patsy, if anybody in this country is going to pass that exam, it's you. Sometimes I even wonder if it's book you eat for breakfast.
Esther laughs. Patsy glances at her. She stops.
Work will always find us. It always does.
It's true, Pat. We have to try and make this our home.
Will it ever be?
None of them know the answer to that. They continue with their cooking.
Hyacinth, stop peppering the meat like that. Remember, it's white people we are feeding.
Well, for all that they put us through, them luckies just pepper.
Winter ball.
Esther can barely contain her excitement.
I've never been to a ball before. Sister said they'll be singing.
It's a wonder this country sees its winter as something to celebrate.
The macaroni pie is nearly perfect. I might sneak a plate upstairs for Charlie.
Esther, I thought my heart was big until I met you.
They all add their finishing touches.
I did try. I did try to find a place, my place, somewhere special. Because Esther, she finds it in people. And you, well, music and carrying on. So I went to a church.
You find it in God?
Well, God listens. And I'm still waiting on the answers.
And what did you ask God for?
To let my grandmother live. I can save as many lives as possible here. Work and save whatever pennies. But I can't buy the time to go back and say thank you.
Esther takes Patsy's dish and puts it in the oven. One less thing to carry.
Sister walks in.
Rarely ever good news.
Sister, we were under the impression that we had an hour in here. Have we overrun? Oh.
A general consensus of confusion among them.
Okay. We'll get our coats.
Scene 9. Outside on hospital grounds, the sound of howling winds, the three women shivering in their coats. It's snowing.
Sister said we can take as long as we want.
might be the nicest thing she's ever said.
What a strange place.
They stand in the snow, at first lost as to what they're expected to do in it, maybe even a bit annoyed by the assignment. And then, with curiosity, with wonder, touching it, smelling it, throwing it, joyfully playing in the snow, we see the innocence and youth that the world frequently denies them. Legacy, scene 10, present. Hyacinth is in her living room watching the television. It's a favourite recording of hers saved on Sky. She might watch it once or twice. We hear cheers, the flashing of photographers.
The royal baby.
Hyacinth beams as if it's a new addition to her family.
George, a very strong name for a little man.
She pauses the TV.
And look right there, behind the flashes, pomp and circumstances, Jacqueline Donkley Bent, the black woman who helped bring him into this world.
Patsy is at the hospital for an appointment. She's sitting in the waiting area.
Some of these present-day nurses have a roughish-looking quality. To me, the trousers just don't look as smart. That's just my personal opinion. But some things are always the same. Even through the tiredness, the cuts and bureaucracy, the struggles rising through the ranks, eyes in the back of your head, ears pricked readily for someone to call your name, finding more fingers than the 10 God gave you to get the job done.
Esther opening her mail, Yvonne making teas.
Would you look at that?
What is it, Mum?
Charlie writing me from Australia.
That's lovely.
Pictures of the wedding.
His mum must be chuffed.
Oh, I bet.
Esther smiling at the picture.
And look at his son, little Oliver.
She laughs.
Just like Charlie did as a baby. Oh, and that child used to cry for me. Not even a plaster they could put on him without Nurse Williams.
You had him spoilt.
That's what he always says.
They never do forget you, Mum.
Yvonne hands Esther a tea.
Well, I was good at my job. Handled everyone with love and care.
You did.
Yvonne sits and sips her tea.
Your patients were lucky. They saw you more than we did.
Hyacinth. Still in front of the TV, rewind and replay the arrival of the royal baby. We hear the cheers.
The first time a newborn baby opens their little eyes, I think about the importance of what they see, the faces, the colors, their blurry shapes. I believe it remains a stamp tucked into the back of our minds, only to surface again in our final moments to complete life. Tidy circle. I think of all the Caribbean women in this country whose gentle hands and peaceful smiles are tucked into the back of the minds of royalty, of the wealthy, of the worthy, of the powerful. And I wonder how a nation's memory can be so short. I think of us crammed onto vessels to work tirelessly, leaving our lives and coming to the mother country, birthing a system and gently tucking it into existence, reviving it each time it grasps within an inch of its life. Whilst our own children sat alone, crying to be held. By the time Marcus came to join me, he was 17. 17, tall, beautiful, and so angry. Angry at the cold, angry at the way the other children laugh at how he speaks. Angry to leave him Granny, Junior, his real family. Angry at me for loving him. Angry at his sister that she didn't have to get my love through letters. Angry at the hours I had to work. Angry at how much he needed to be held. Angry at all the time we couldn't get back. Errol told me boys are different. Give him time. And time helped. He settled, studied. It was never quite peace, but he got close enough to understanding why it was worth being ripped from all he knew. And I learned to understand how to make space for his hurt and how it sits between us on the sofa. But it's on the days where I switch on my telly to watch current affairs that we feel closest. I hear the screen making all the sounds it did 40 years ago. My daughter and grandchildren asking me, when will it stop? When will it stop, Grandma? Look, see them take to the streets. And when I'm tired, to make all words sound hopeful and new, my markers will just put on a record and smile. Holding on to his glass like mommy did, like it's keeping him steady. Happy to be here to protect us if the world won't. And in those moments, the sun shine on Bedford like he was a boy in Jamaica.
Hyacinth reaches for her small wooden box of trinkets and secrets, places it on her lap, allows her hand to rest there.
It's a pain in my knee. I wouldn't have called it a serious incident, so it took a while to pin down. Nothing stood out to me as out of the ordinary. But the nurse kindly reminded me that a fall might feel like a bump to a busy woman. And that jogged my memory. Yes, yes. Come to think of it, I did have a little difficulty buying some bits in the Harper Center. People were very kind. She smiled. Sometimes we move too fast to listen to our bodies. And when I asked her how she was finding the job, she just paused for a moment, thought about it, and said, "Hard. But we don't do it because it's easy. We do it because we care. I hope someone's taking care of her, because when we're all patched up and sent home, doctors and nurses need to smile too."
"I don't say it to upset you, Mum."
"Well, it's not nice to hear."
"It's the truth. It's my truth. Growing up, your career took front and centre. And it's not that you didn't love us, didn't dress us good for school and church. You just weren't around."
"Yvonne, all we could do was our best. You'll never understand the sacrifice."
"I try to. I know it was huge."
"Bigger than huge. I have friends whose family had to sell land to get them here. My sister Ingrid, God rest her soul, gave up all her savings. I told her as a girl that one day my house would be used to take care of people. And she paid for that dream, forgot about her own, prepared for your future before you were even a thought in my mind. So when you see I was letting patients visit on weekends, and taking them in, even after they've been discharged, I was just doing right by her. And through teaching you kindness, trying to do right by you.
The words of Anarin Bevan continued to carry me as I studied for my finals and throughout my early career. Mr. Simmons knew what he was doing with that book. At times, his words were a rallying cry, a reminder that often doing good isn't easy. It requires going against the grain. I learned how he was passionately opposed when first creating the NHS. People thinking it was ludicrous, medical practitioners even withdrawing their service months before it was launched. The determination it took to see that through. For the idea to survive, the fight. I would sit haunched under a lamp, bleary-eyed, but excited, saying, "That's like us, just like us, me and the girls." Until, like always, my digging would lead to some heart-sinking discovery that would leave us out in the cold. Something clean-cut and silencing like, "Colonial subjects cannot come here and complain. If all is not plain sailing," 1948. It's a tricky business, heroizing people in this country. But I never stopped wondering if he felt victorious, if he ever got a chance to step back and look at what he created, if he would still feel proud today. 3 years of general nurse training. All those tears, that sweat, and the laughter signified by my silver buckle. 25 pounds it cost. My salary year one was only 10 pounds, 15 shillings per month. And sitting on the phone, listening to my grandmother cry tears of joy when she received a picture of me wearing it in the post. That was victory, the closest it's ever felt.
Scene 11, Bedford Charter Market. Patsy and Esther inspecting the fruit.
Esther, come and feel this one.
Not ripe.
Patsy hands her another one.
Dinner for the flies.
Patsy gives up.
You ever imagine as a child we'd have to work this hard to find one good mango?
Esther laughs. Enter Hyacinth with a trolley.
Late, as usual.
Well, Patsy, woman plans and God decides. Right on time in the eyes of the Lord.
Esther chuckles. Hyacinth has never lost her gift for getting underneath Patsy's skin.
Besides, I had a busy morning on the phone.
Hyacinth now inspecting some planting before putting it in her basket.
3 more nurses who are interested in joining our group. 2 from Grenada, 1 from St. Kitts. Trained in Sheffield and London.
Really?
Hyacinth nods. They're all quietly pleased.
Well, we'd better make the preparations.
Patsy begins to double up on portions in her basket. More slices of home to share. More offerings and ways of bridging the gap between oceans.
Yvonne did tell me off. She said, "Mom, how are you retired and still managing to find work?"
The women laugh.
I had to explain that this was a different kind of work for my spirit.
They sounded interested?
Very.
What did you tell them?
Well,
Hyacinth thinks. She delivers this quite plainly, as if it's taken time to mine her experiences into this nugget, and she's content with it.
That statues and medals and public apologies don't heal like sharing stories. Just a space where we can call back on our first winters and all of the winters we've survived since.
They continue to shop, diligently sifting through for the best their islands have to offer. In their faces, we see hope, a renewed sense of purpose.